You get started? You ready, Andrew?
I am ready.
Okay. All right. Maybe I'll just. Okay, welcome everyone, and welcome to Global Friday. This is the seminar series that shines a spotlight on issues of global and international significance. My name is Gary Wilson. I'm a professor in the Department of Political Science, and I'm part of the organizing committee for Global Fridays. I'd like to begin today by acknowledging that we are seated on the unceded and traditional territory of the Kliklitane, and very grateful and to be situated on this territory and to live and work in this territory. We have two speakers today who are going to be talking about the future of NATO. Chris Kilford, who is the president of CIC Victoria, Canadian International Council Victoria, and Andrew Rasulis, who is based in Ottawa. I'm going to pass it over to Sean Simmons, who is the president of the local chapter of CIC, to introduce both of them and get them started on their topic. So thank you and welcome.
Thank you very much, Gary. Yeah, and welcome to everyone online as well as people in the audience. This is actually our first hybrid event where we have an in-person audience as well as an audience online. And we've been fortunate enough to have Chris Kilford here for the last 2 days, or since Wednesday night. We've done two events. We did a politics in the pub last night, and we did a presentation with Winston. So this is the final presentation with Chris here. And we're so happy to have Andrew Rasulis here as a co-presenter. So just a quick overview about CIC. It's a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization dedicated to international issues from a Canadian perspective. And in particular, I know there's a large student audience here. And one of the key values of being a member of CIC is that you get access to people who have lived and had incredible experiences in foreign affairs, in the military, in international media. So we encourage everyone who's not already a member to sign up and come talk to me if you have any questions. So without further ado, let me introduce today's first speaker, if I can get to the page, is Andrew Rasulis. In 1979, Mr. Rasulis joined the Department of National Defense and has served in many posts during his tenure, including section head in the Directorate of Nuclear and Arms Control Policy, defense advisor to the Canadian delegation for conventional arms control talks in Vienna, section head responsible for policy on Central and Eastern Europe, and director of military training assistance program and Eastern European policy. Mr. Rasulis's MA thesis on the utility of war in the nuclear age developed a theory on limited conventional war and published as a Wellesley paper in 1981. Mr. Rasulis is retired from DNT and is now a freelance consultant, and welcome, Andrew.
Thank you very much. Thank you. So if I am to lead off then, and thank you very much for the warm welcome. And it's great to be with you and meet so many of you, but also to be working with my old friend and colleague, Chris. So before we understand where's this going in terms of NATO and the war and Russia and everything, I think it's very important to understand how we got here, because it just didn't happen overnight. In fact, I would suggest that this has a direct line back to the so-called end of the Cold War, the events of 1989 and 1991. So let me explain what I mean by that. I mean, it's a popular assumption that the Cold War ended peacefully, and wasn't Gorbachev a great guy, and you know, all that stuff. Well, I would suggest that what the Cold War was comprised of two elements. On the first hand, it was ideological, communism versus capitalism. And that did end peacefully in 1989, 91, that period, when Gorbachev recognized, and most people recognized, that the communist system was effectively defunct. There was a move, rapid move then, in Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union and throughout the Warsaw Pact countries to adapt from a Soviet or communist system to a capitalist system of various types. What didn't end, and this is what I think why we're in the war today, the largest war in Europe since 1945, is the power conflicts. The power relationship didn't end, it morphed. So the other, the Soviet Union, in effect, was also a, well, it was a nuclear superpower, as Russia remains a nuclear superpower. But the Soviet Union, in effect, inherited many traits of Imperial Russia. And I mean, Stalin's concept of communism first in Russia and building outward also very much was based on concept of the Soviet Empire being the Russian Empire. And in 1991, when essentially the Soviet Union collapses itself and begins the withdrawal of its forces over time from the former Warsaw Pact, including East Germany, what we see is a power politics phase continuing. It was almost imperceptible because the Russians were so weak. And this is the Yeltsin now period. So Gorbachev is displaced, Yeltsin takes over, and it's a very, very chaotic period in Russian history. There is flirtation with democracy. There is flirtations with various forms of capitalism. It's the Wild West out there. And in that period, and I will make two personal references, one a bit to my own personal experiences that I had in that period. I was a player there. And also, not to compare myself at all, but Putin was also a player here. And his personal experiences, I think, relate to his actions today as well. So permit me a bit of personal nuance in this story. So when this all collapses from Putin's point of view, he's in East Germany when the wall's coming down in 89. He's in Dresden. He's one of the senior KGB chiefs there. Basically, he holds off this demonstrating crowd of East Germans who want to raid the archives of the KGB, and he holds them off with a pistol, so goes the story. This has a lasting impact on him. And at the end of the day, after the, in 1991, when the coup occurs, the August coup, this is the reactionaries to Gorbachev, Putin resigns his KGB commission and returns to Moscow, to now what was Leningrad, to St. Petersburg. And although he retains maybe a reserve role in the KGB, he joins the municipality government of St. Petersburg. And in that capacity, he doesn't make enough money to live. And he drives a taxi or his own vehicle, which is a hire thing. And that is an extremely humiliating point for him. So when he talks about later in life, he says that the collapse of the Soviet Union was a great tragedy. He's also talking not about the fall of communism as such, but yes, the fall of Imperial Russia and the and that Soviet space, yes, but also a personal feeling that happened to himself and millions of Russians who suffered this period of calamity as they transitioned from communism to capitalism. So this feeling remains with him. And there is a story, I can't verify it, that in when he was doing his taxi driving moonlighting job, that he at one time, so the story goes, he drove CIA guys who had come with, as like the old carpetbaggers to help the Russians with their reformations of their intelligence services. And this, from a Putin point of view, was extremely humiliating. Whether the story is true or not, but I think conceptually it's important to understand Putin's mind frame in all this period. And my own experience in the 1990s, this period of chaos, is I was, one of my jobs was, of course, to handle Canadian bilateral defense relations with Russia. And in that process, I did annual Russia-Canada staff talks, sometimes in Canada, sometimes in Russia. In that process, I dealt extensively with Russian military, and as well as foreign policy people. And they told me repeatedly over the years between 1992 when I started doing these talks, or 93, sorry, until roughly 2000, that Russia, while on its heels, was going to come back as a power. They weren't talking about communism. Everyone forgot about that. But Russia as a great power was going to come back. And I always remember that. So we see that. So the actions that I'm now going to outline, there's a logic to all this stuff. And there's, in my view, a continuum. So now, and also the other important thing to say is there are two divergent narratives. There's a kind of a Western perspective as to what happened and a Russian perspective as to what happened. So, you know, the NATO view is essentially, the Western view is that while we expanded after the collapse of the Soviet Union, that we expanded the zone of stability, democracy, and that was all good. And we did what the people of Eastern Europe wanted us to do. And of course, there's a Russian perspective that this is in fact an incursion of NATO, which should not have expanded after the Cold War, that basically the power relationship should have been settled and should have been status quo, but NATO kept moving eastward. And that, in terms of the power relationship, the Russians never got over it. Now, in the 1990s, they were too weak to do something about it. They made protestations, and from their point of view, NATO just sort of said, forget about it. We're moving forward. And they did. Now, the first time you have a real serious confrontation between NATO and Russia is in the Yugoslav Civil War, in the last days, in the bombing of Pristina, or the airport Pristina, but this is the bombing of Kosovo, where you have Russian peacekeepers on the ground with NATO peacekeepers. But there's a confrontation over the Pristina airport. And General Clark, the American, who's head of all the peacekeepers in that area, and the Russians had refused to actually put themselves under NATO command, but they were operating there in coordination with NATO command. When General Clark, the British general, was sent with his paratroopers to actually seize control Pristina airport, he found 200 Russians there, commanded by a general officer. And basically it was a showdown. The Russians weren't gonna give it up. They were gonna hold it. And Jackson reports this to Clark. Clark says, well, you must take it. And Jackson's famous response is, I'm not gonna start World War III for you, okay? Long story short, the issues are resolved. There's some whiskey involved and the matter is peacefully resolved. The point, though, is that is an important confrontation. It doesn't blow up, but it's there. And the Russians are noticing it. Now, this is now late 90s, okay? The Russians have been saying, we're coming back. Then you have Putin coming on board in 2000. For his first few years of his rule, up until, let's say, 2005, 6, he's trying to work with NATO. He's trying to be the helpful guy. Afghanistan, he's trying to help. Let's work together. He has this vision that Russia, this is a sort of the Russia part of Europe concept, and that we could work as a great power. And he doesn't get that resonance. Lots of complications, he doesn't get it. So now we get in the timetable to war. In 2007, Putin has made a fundamental assessment. He can't work with the West. This isn't going anywhere. So he goes to the Munich Defense Conference and he makes his statement. From his point of view, the Russian narrative, we're not taking this anymore. You, NATO, can't push against us. It's going to stop. NATO interpretation, Putin's getting very aggressive. He's sort of declaring verbal war against us or something like that. So there's the two narratives are now really diverging. So the next thing is, of course, right in 2008, the Bucharest NATO summit. And they invite Ukraine and Georgia to join. Unspecified timings, but in principle. And this comes after a series of NATO enlargements, which the Russians have routinely protested, and basically NATO's ignored. And one of the most difficult, I think, for the Russians was the accession of the three Baltic states, former members of the Soviet Union, are now part of NATO. Now, this is really tough for them to swallow. So when the Georgians, reacting to the Bucharest statement a year prior, start making really aggressive moves to say, we want to join NATO, the Russians go to war. August 2008, they go to war against Georgia, a short war. They actually don't do very well conventionally, and they have to do a lot of reforms. But they win. They take South Ossetia, they take the Abkhazia, and they say to the Georgians, you've lost these areas right now and you're not going to NATO. And NATO backs off too and says, okay, right. So got to settle everything out. So that's the next step. Then there's a bit of quietness until 1415. This is, of course, the Maidan Revolt, I'm not going to go through the detailed history of all that. But the point is that this really sparks again. This is now Ukraine trying to go west. And basically, the Russians saying, no, you're not. And when the Maidan revolt starts, the Russians immediately seize Crimea, which has the Black Sea Fleet there, which had never left. They had a lease arrangement with Ukraine since 1991. But now the Russians are saying, well, it's all off. All the bets are off. We're not taking a risk here. We're taking it. Oh, and by the way, Crimea is historically Russian. So forget the 1991 stuff. Forget 1954. So this is, and then we have the Minsk too. There's again another possibility maybe to resolve this peacefully. But, you know, Crimea stays Russian, semi-autonomy for the rebel states of Eastern Ukraine, all that sort of stuff. And things go very quickly nowhere until the Russians start to make real strong noises in 2021 with bringing up forces to exercise on Ukraine's borders in the spring and then in the fall with a Putin summit with Biden in Geneva in July. All this to try to avert the NATO accession issue for the Russians to make them feel that Ukraine is not going to join. And there's a number of diplomatic moves taking place. The Americans offer all sorts of negotiations. At the end of the day, and this story comes out afterwards, in the final meeting on video teleconference between Biden and Putin in December 2021, essentially the story goes, we didn't know it at the time, but Biden says to Putin, you know, why don't you do negotiations with us on framework of Europe? Because Ukraine's not going to get into NATO for another 10 years. And Putin's apparent response was, what happens in year 11? And the point is that his security people, and the Russians were divided. I mean, I think I'm convinced that Lavrov actually wanted to go the negotiating route. And there was an element of the elites in Moscow that wanted to do that. But there was also the security people, elite apparatus, who said, no, we're going to just be sucked in. It'll be 10 years of negotiation. Ukraine will continue to get stronger, will continue to move further with NATO, and at the end of the negotiations, we'll lose. So basically, it's now or never. We have a military capability to take them quickly, and everyone thought that. NATO's intelligence thought that the Russians could do this. Big mistake, of course, but they thought they could. So they convinced themselves, the Russians did, that they could do the strategic operation and bring down the Zelensky government, neutralize Ukraine, and sort out the whole Minsk arrangements to their favor and establish a buffer zone, keep NATO out. And it didn't work, of course. So we have this massive war that starts in February. We all know where that's gone. And of course, it goes really sideways from the Russian point of view in terms of the NATO space, sort of the carving out the sphere of influence, because now basically de facto in this war, Ukraine is very close to NATO. In fact, you can argue, there are certain Russians see it, that Ukraine is now a proxy of NATO. And that basically what's happened is this is not no longer a special operation between NATO, sort of Russia and Ukraine. This is de facto a war between NATO and Russia with Ukraine as a proxy. Now it's de facto and there's no direct combat. It's sort of like Vietnam, with the American boots on the ground, but the Chinese and Soviets supplying with everything, but actually not going into a one-to-one war. So where do we go on now? Now we've got this terrible space where you've got the threat of nuclear weapons, although Putin has never said nuclear weapons, he said our full arsenal. But there's a lot of discussion, what does this mean? President Biden last night in a meeting, a fundraiser for the Democrats, said that we are now the closest to Armageddon, mutual assured destruction, since the Cuban Missile Crisis of 62. He also said that he himself, Biden, is just wondering what Putin's off-ramp might be. So this is where we are today. And we've also had, by the way, and I'm sure Chris will talk more from the Turkish angle, the potential accession of Sweden and Finland to NATO. So the Russians are getting more NATO, not less NATO, and the Baltic Sea has the potential of becoming a Baltic lake. Now, as we know, Turkey has still not agreed. They've agreed to review the process, but they haven't agreed to affirm it. And so the problem of the Kurds and the refugees in Finland and Sweden, and particularly Sweden, I believe, is a stickler. And Chris will, I'm sure, speak on this point. So whether Finland and Sweden actually join NATO is still some measure of discussion. But the point is that we have the large-scale war in Europe now, in terms of actual combat between Ukraine and Russia, with NATO in full support of equipment, training, money, but not boots on the ground, of course, and no Article 5, but almost everything else but. And Zelensky saying there's no negotiating with Putin. Zelensky, the Ukraine signed a protocol saying we cannot negotiate with him, which means this is an open-ended war, basically a war, to use that classic phrase, to be settled by the force of arms. So it's like pretty dangerous stuff out there. So this is where we sit today. And NATO's heavily involved. We don't know where this is going to go. We're sitting here October 7th, Putin's birthday. He's keeping a low profile on it. But basically, this is a very dynamic situation. We can speculate. But I would only throw out to you, because I think in all this, what I think Biden is reacting to, we're just talking of Armageddon, is that Putin is signaling, not that he's going to use nuclear weapons, but that he has nuclear weapons. He also has large strategic conventional weapons. He can use strategic conventional bombing, bear bombers. Like, think of the Americans and their B-17s in Vietnam. Putin, think Russia, you know, carpet bombing Ukraine. That's a theoretical thing, but they have the capability, short of nuclear war. But I think that Putin is saying is nuclear superpowers don't lose wars. Okay. So we're not going to lose this war. This is where we are. And I'll leave that with you. And I'm happy to engage and answer your questions, of course. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Andrew. Very informative. I love the anecdotes on Putin. I got this picture of him driving a cab with some CIA agents in the back. That's very, very entertaining. So our next speaker is Chris Kilford. Chris is a member of the National Board of the Canadian International Council and president of the CIC Victoria branch. He holds a PhD in history from Queen's University, has enjoyed a 36-year career in the Canadian Armed Forces, and has served in the Department of National Defense in Canada's embassy in Kabul, Afghanistan, as deputy military attaché, and also at the embassy in Ankara, Turkey, as a Canadian defense attaché. Since retiring from the military, Chris has become a recognized expert on Turkish foreign policy and Middle Eastern political issues. Welcome, Chris.
Thank you. I'm just gonna do a test, Andrew. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, I can.
Okay, perfect. And first of all, thank you, Gary and Sean, for the invitation to be here and to take part in this event. Thank you for spending your time also here. This is my first trip to Prince George, my first time visiting the university. I spoke yesterday twice on this very important subject, and I hope I can share everything with you that I have here in the time available. I want to say hi to all my friends in Victoria that I know are online. So I'm actually in Prince George. I'm not in Victoria. So hi to you. Yes, and thank you, Andrew, for leading off and giving us the background to this entire situation. So what I thought I would do today is talk about a trip that I made to Latvia recently to visit our troops there. I stopped in Turkey. Now Turkey A, of course, they want you to call the country Turkey A. That's the new official name. I will not say that during the talk today. I'll just use Turkey, because if I start out saying Turkey A, I'll soon revert to Turkey because the old brain box doesn't work as well as it used to. So it's Turkey today. I'm gonna talk about President Zelensky. I'll talk about Putin. I'll talk about Canada and our role in this war that's ongoing in Ukraine. And then a few other ideas about what might come next and build on what Andrew has had to say. I first went to the Soviet Union in 1978 as a student. I was, I think, 16 years old. And we went to Kyiv and Moscow and Leningrad at the time. It's fascinating. I've always been interested in Russia and the whole Soviet experience my entire life. When I joined the military, I was 17, and I filled out the forms at the recruiting center, pretty normal stuff, name, address, telephone number. And then there was this block that said, have you ever visited a communist country? And I had to write the Soviet Union. And I remember the sergeant taking my forms and doing this double take because, you know, back then you didn't visit the Soviet Union. Under special circumstances, yes. But the average person in the West would never travel to the Soviet Union. Certainly they wouldn't come to see you. So it was kind of unique to be in that position. And Sean mentioned that I was a military attaché at one point. I retired from the military in 2014, and people often ask me what a military attaché actually does. And I was in the embassy in Ankara, and I was responsible for military to military relations with the Turkish armed forces. So mutual training, that sort of thing. I was cross-accredited to Georgia. Andrew mentioned the war in 2008. So I was often in Tbilisi and in Baku in Azerbaijan. I was cross-accredited there and also Turkmenistan. So I got to travel the region and see what was going on. But my main role on the ground was to keep an eye on what was happening in Syria, in Iraq, in Iran, and so on, and report back to Ottawa so that instead of just watching BBC or CNN, they actually had an independent voice on the ground trying to make sense of what we were seeing. That was my job for three years. I've been teaching since 2014, but this summer in August, I'd asked our armed forces if I could visit our troops in Latvia. We have about 700 Canadian Forces personnel that are stationed in Latvia as part of a battle group, so lots of weapons helping the Latvians, but more importantly, joining them are about 11 other NATO countries. And so the battle group's about 1,300 soldiers. So when I sat with the Canadian commanding officer, his number two was a Spanish officer. And over there were a group of Albanian soldiers. And over there, a bunch from Montenegro. And it was Canada that was bringing them all together to create this military group that is designed to tell the Russians, especially after Crimea in 2014, that was far enough, that we were there to protect our Latvian friends from any sort of aggression on the part of the Russians. It reminded me of my time when I visited our troops, of being in Laar and Baden-Solingen, two big Canadian bases that we had in Germany during the Cold War. And what we'd actually done in this particular case is picked up those bases and moved them closer to Moscow. And I actually see our Canadian presence in Latvia being permanent. Because regardless of what happens to Putin after all of this, whether he stays or he goes, if you're in Latvia or Estonia or any of the Eastern European countries, they're incredibly concerned that Russia will continue to be unstable for some time to come. So they need our help. And for us, Latvia seems such a far, far away place. But if you're Latvian, if you had the Latvian ambassador here today, he would tell you that Canada's role in their country is vital for their security. And in fact, our small Canadian forces, if you were in Romania right now, if we were off to the local Starbucks and we saw a fighter jet flying overhead and you looked up, it would be one of ours. We are currently providing air defense coverage for Romania in conjunction with their air force. So the Canadian military finds itself all over the place quite often. What was also quite surprising to be at Camp Adazi outside of Riga, Latvia, was the fact there was a Tim Hortons. Very important if you're Canadians deploying overseas. And one of the funniest things was my colleagues telling me that you had all of these Italian soldiers lining up for Tim Hortons coffee, coming from the wonderful coffee culture of Italy, but they were quite happy to line up for Tim Hortons. So very, very important. But I think a lot has changed since February 2002 in places such as Latvia because of the invasion. Now, what do I mean by that? Latvia has a population of 2 million people, 25% of them ethnic Russians. And up until this particular point, the Kremlin was very adept at stirring things up in Latvia when it suited their purposes, be it the media, pro-Russian parties in the Latvian government, and so forth. But since the invasion, the Latvian government has felt quite empowered. So while I was there in August, I was surprised to see that Riga had declared Moscow a state sponsor of terrorism, that a monument to Soviet soldiers was toppled, which would not have happened prior to February. And in the most recent elections on the 1st of October, the pro-Kremlin parties in Latvia were pretty much wiped out. They had 25% of the seats in the parliament beforehand, but not today. So we've seen some fundamental shifts with the Kremlin losing its influence throughout Eastern Europe. I'm still though watching elections in, we've got Bulgaria and Bosnia and Herzegovina. We'll see how that plays out. But the Russians have lost so much since the invasion of Ukraine in February. Now, after I left Latvia, I headed down to Turkey because I used to be stationed there. I have friends who are journalists and military officers, and I actually ended up in the Turkish Ministry of Foreign Affairs for 90 minutes drinking tea with the former Turkish Canadian, our Turkish ambassador to Canada, right? Now I have to say, and I know we're being recorded, and so sorry to my Turkish friends if you're listening, most Turkish diplomats are quite stoic, not really willing to discuss a lot with you because they live in a country that has many, many challenges. But I think Canada has rubbed off on my Turkish friends who are now back in Ankara because they were happy to sit and chat, and we talked over a lot of different issues, Russia, Ukraine, Iraq, Syria, and the like. And it was important to hear what they had to say. The challenge for Turkey, of course, it's a NATO member. It's been a NATO member since 1952, but it does find itself in a very complex part of the world. And when they look at what's happened in Ukraine, and like Andrew was saying with the expansion of NATO, they actually blame the West for a lot of this. They blame us. Why? Well, yes, NATO expanded. That put pressure on the Kremlin. But NATO and America, of course, have run amok in the Middle East, as we know, starting in 1991, 2003, toppling Gaddafi in Libya in 2011, trying to get rid of Bashar al-Assad in Syria, starting in the period of the Arab Spring, and so forth. And the spillover effects in the region have been incredible. Difficult for the Europeans who've had to take in refugees and so forth, Turkey as well, 4 million roughly Syrians. Every day in Turkey, 500 children are born to those refugees. And Turkey is not a rich country. In fact, right now inflation is running at about 85% officially. And the country is suffering economically. So they're looking after all of these people at the same time. But let's be fair, it pales in comparison to what has happened on the ground in places like Syria and so on for the people of those countries. But my point is, if you're Turkey, you're sitting there and you've got so many challenges all around you, no matter where you look. And you're very heavily dependent on Russia for energy supplies, for tourism, all of that. And that's why they haven't moved, like the rest of Europe, to place sanctions on the Russians as we have. But they are also NATO allies and would tell you that they have done a number of things to support Ukraine. For example, they've closed the Bosphorus to military traffic. They negotiated between Russia and Ukraine to have grain flow from Ukraine out to international markets. They closed their airspace to Russian military flights heading into Syria. So they would say, we're doing our part, and we're also looking out for our own interests. Now, I don't personally like it. I don't think we should be helping Putin in any fashion whatsoever. However, when I do stand back and try to be neutral about it, if there is one country at the end of the day, should we get there, that can sit down with Russia and Ukraine and negotiate some sort of end to this war, it's probably the people in Ankara. And that's why maybe their stance over all of this is to our advantage in the long term. Now, what about the actual war itself? there's just a couple of things I want to focus on. I think the vital ground in much of this has been President Zelensky. He is a master communicator. I'm sure many of you know that he went to school, to university, and became a lawyer, but then decided it was better to be an actor. He had his television show, Servant of the People, where he played a high school professor that becomes the president of Ukraine. And then in Life Imitating Art in 2019, he became the president of Ukraine. And Ukraine's got lots of challenges, corruption, et cetera, we know this. But Zelensky was perhaps that one person that could have started to sort things out. But in February, of course, we had the invasion. But since then, whether he's talking to the Canadian Parliament or to some high school students, his ability to communicate with people about the war has been fundamental to what we're seeing. You know, in those early days when the invasion happened, we'd expected, I think most of us, in 2 to 3 days, it would all be over. And why not? I mean, Russia had entered into Syria in 2015 and stabilized the situation there. Georgia, they had their way in 2008. They took Crimea. The West barely blinked and put some sanctions on them. I'm sure once he saw what happened in Afghanistan with our, in this case, Andrew, a nuclear superpower essentially losing a war. I'm sure he looked at that and said, the West, as he talked about in his speech the other day, is decadent and weak. And that's what drove a lot of his thinking. Get into Kyiv, take over the country, the West won't do a thing. Maybe a few sanctions, but we can live with that. But it all went sideways, of course. The Ukrainians were able to stop those early advances. In some respects, that was because of us, Canada, Canadians, because we've been training the Ukrainian military since 2017. 30,000 Ukrainian troops passed through our hands, whether it was combat first aid, firing weapons, or operational planning. But the real key was not the hands-on stuff. It was training, changing the mindset of the Ukrainian armed forces. The Ukrainian armed forces was built on a Soviet model, a top-down model, where the generals told you what to do and the rest of you got on with it. And your options to take chances, risks, that sort of thing when things went sideways, it really didn't exist. And so with our personnel at their officer staff colleges, we started to say to them, you need to empower the junior officers. You need to have a senior non-commissioned corps, your sergeant. So when the major is killed, the captain can take over. And then the sergeant will take over. And then the corporal will take over. But that's not the way the Soviet or Russian military works. It's top down. Those at the bottom, when there's a problem, are paralyzed. And you would have seen in the early stages of this war, so many Russian senior generals being killed at the front lines. 2-star, 3-star generals having to come to the very front lines to sort issues out, and they were killed. And so this ability of the Ukrainian military to adapt on the ground has been fundamental. And then from a Canadian perspective, again, those Bayraktar drones that Turkey provided to Ukraine before the war, these are big drones, you know, the wingspan from wall to wall. They hang up there for 24 hours, flown by a ground crew 150 kilometers away, missiles underneath them. Underneath, though, is a ball. It's about that big. It's got all the cameras and the laser rangefinder, and it's built in Burlington, Ontario. It's a Canadian product. It is the brains of that system. And those Bayraktars were absolutely fundamental to stopping those Russian initial advances. So after those first few days, we waited to see what might happen. Weren't quite sure. Still thought the Ukrainians wouldn't win. They'd be finished. And then a week went by, and 2 weeks went by, and a couple of months went by. And once the West began to see that there was a chance that Ukraine would hold on, we began to show up with money, with weaponry, and we've seen the reaction on the Russian side. Sheer panic, because their soldiers are losing on the battlefield. Of course, the poor Ukrainian people, don't get me wrong, they're suffering through all of this. And now we see Russia mobilizing 300,000 young men, to toss them into the front lines. What does that actually mean at the end of the day, other than desperation? We tend to look through a lot of what happens in the world with a Western lens. If you've lived here all your life, you look at things through a Western lens. And so we see this call up of reserve soldiers. And if you're looking at it from a Western perspective, you think, oh yeah, reserve soldiers, they probably had a bit of, you know, real military training, maybe some supplementary training, and they've gone home and then now they're being called up. Well, in the Russian sense, the training that they have received is about a year long. Many of them don't even touch a rifle. They're just used for menial labor. And it's awful, the experience is awful. And then they go home and they're happy to leave it all behind them. But now they're getting called up. But they don't go through a 6-month preparatory period. I hear a lot of analysts say, well, it's going to take a time, some time to get these young men into the front lines because they've got to go through the 6 months of preparation. That's what we do. We do that for our troops, as well-trained as they are, before they go into combat. But that's not what happens on the Russian side. You're just given a rifle, a uniform, and off you go, and good luck. And this is going to be, in the next few weeks, an absolute catastrophe on the home front and on the front lines if you're Russian. There we go with that bit of good news. But this is how that situation will start to play out. Where will this all end up at the end of the day? If you asked me a couple of months ago, if we were doing this talk, I would have had about 6 or 7 options up on the board as to how this could actually play out. And now when I look at the situation, I tend to believe that Putin's days are numbered. Now you'll have any number of people give you their options, and I'm just telling you mine. I think Putin's health will deteriorate in one way or another, and he won't be around. And I think if you're in Kyiv, you're probably looking at the situation on the ground and saying to yourself, I'm not only going to take back the territories in Luhansk and around Kherson and all of that, but I'm actually going to go after the whole of Crimea. And I would sense that you might see an outflow of ethnic Russians from Crimea into Russia proper in the very near future. So that is where I believe this war is going from my view of things today. There's a lot more to explore. I've got a lot more in my notes, but I'm going to stop here so that we can go to Q&A. And see where that conversation takes us. So I'll hand back the floor to Gary.
Maybe I'll just let you take your own questions, and if there's questions for Andrew, then or you can both answer the questions in turn with that.
Yeah. How the questions come?
We'll have some questions online, probably in the Q&A online.
Right.
If you're getting questions from the audience, it's better to repeat them.
Will do.
Because not everybody can hear.
Okay.
Way back there.
Do you want me to look at the questions online myself? Or?
Let's see what we've got here. Q&A, we don't have any yet.
I know Paul Meyer raised
his
hand.
We have 76 people online, so yeah. That's good. But nothing yet.
We'll
just wait. Yeah, so people online, if you want to just put your questions in the Q&A, we can answer them that way, and we'll keep our eyes on that.
Sure. Yeah. Okay, so everybody heard that. Please type don't raise your hands. And Rod, I see you raised your hands. Please use the Q&A function at the bottom and type your question there, and we'll do our best to get to them. Thanks. Anybody? Yes, please.
Hi, I'm Mary Hala. I'm just looking back to the talk. What's been going on in the talk? I have a few things that trouble me, mainly because I think maybe that was the intention, but Turkey came off as sort of like the good guy in the story. And from the perspective of the Middle East, Turkey has done some significant damage to try and undermine grassroots movements that are essentially for democracy, for sovereignty. Specifically, I'm talking about the Kurdish movement in Turkey, but also in Syria, as well as in Iraq. Quite recently, Turkey bombed a tourist area in northern Iraq, Saqqo, which killed families. Most of them were children. We didn't hear anything from the Syrian government nor the United States. But when Iran bombed also at the Kurdish side of Iraq, condemnation were coming from everywhere. Mm-hmm. So I think it's important to highlight that Turkey is not stuck in this challenging situation, but it is started sort of, it is the one that's instigating that list, at least from the Middle East perspective. For Mr. Andrew, if I may ask, recently, Jeffrey Sachs, who's a professor at University of Columbia, he was an economist for Poland and for Moscow, right after the collapse of the Soviet Union. He made recommendations to for NATO to help Poland to rebuild its economy, and he made the same recommendations for Moscow, but of course only NATO followed through with Poland. Recently, he was cut off the air when he suggested that it was the United States that bombed the gas pipe recently. So I was wondering if you could comment on that a little. Thank you.
So, Andrew, what I'll do is I'll start with the question on Turkey and çok teşekkür ederim. So if I was doing a talk on Turkey, which I often do, I would explore all of those issues. It's the reason why Canada has an arms embargo on Turkey itself, because of their military actions, especially in Syria. And I fully agree with you that Turkey's actions in Iraq, where they have troops stationed permanently, I've been all through that area. They have a lot to answer for themselves. There's no question. And if you've been following the news, President Erdogan signaled today that he was ready to sit down with Bashar al-Assad and essentially throw the Syrian opposition under the bus, right? So Turkey pivots all the time in their interests, but it means that many people are affected by what they do. So indeed, in the case of Ukraine, though, I'm simply focused on them and what's happening in Ukraine. And they do walk a very fine line. You may recall in 2015, Turkey shot down a Russian jet fighter. In 2016, the Russian ambassador in Ankara on television was assassinated by an off-duty policeman. 33 Turkish soldiers were killed by the Syrian Air Force in Idlib 2020. And so the relationship they have with Russia is a really love-hate one, transactional, if you like. I think Turkey would easily throw Vladimir Putin under the bus when it suits them. But now they see it in their interests to deal with them. I simply would say that in this particular case, their relationship with Moscow and Kyiv would probably work to our advantage, perhaps theirs as well, but for us in particular. But I would love to talk to you about Turkey and all of these things, perhaps at another time. Thank you for that question. Andrew, I'll turn over to you.
Thanks, Chris. I could barely hear the audience question. Could you please summarize that for me?
Yeah, I couldn't because I was thinking about answering my question. Could you just repeat that again?
Jeffrey Sachs, who was an economist for Poland in a former USSR moment, he recently was on air. He's a professor at the University of Columbia, who was recently on air suggesting that it was the United States that bombed the pipeline. So I was wondering if you could comment on that.
Okay, so, pipeline.
Did you hear that, Andrew?
Yes, I did. Yeah, the pipeline conspiracy. Whoa. Okay, so Andrew Rasulis does not know who did it, but Andrew Rasulis will tell you that actually, politically speaking, the United States and the Ukrainians have the most to gain by it. But that's not saying they did it. The Swedish people, the Swedes who are examining it closely are saying it was sabotage, okay? So I'll leave it as to who done it. But in terms of motives, it's the old clue game, right? Of course, everyone has something to gain by it, as Pierrot would say. But in terms of specifics, politically speaking, though, literally, the Americans and the Ukrainians were the most opposed to the Nord Stream lines. So the fact that they blow, you know, serves American and Ukrainian interests. You can also say that the Russians kind of using an indirect way of cutting the gas off, but, you know, I think the Russians want to cut the gas off, and one day they might still. There's a whole bunch of other pipelines coming in to Europe through Ukraine that we're not even talking about, but there's tons going through already still.
Do you want online? And then
we have like a lot of questions online here.
I'll let you take it, Chris. I better have one person doing it. So you, and then if you want to direct it to me, please.
Sure. Well, a quick one. Peter wrote, would you please comment on how the upcoming winter conditions will impact the combatants on both sides? Well, it gets very cold in Ukraine during the wintertime. But if you can imagine the Russian military being so ill-equipped now, with whether it's helmets or rifles or just food, general logistics, where is the winter warfare equipment going to come from? And I had this question yesterday, and I answered it by this. I said, I can imagine right now that winter warfare equipment from NATO countries is flowing into Ukraine in preparation for winter warfare conditions. And so I would imagine that for the Russian side, it will be very difficult, but for the Ukrainians, less so, because they'll be better equipped for the conditions that they're going to face. So there's a quick answer there, Peter. And perhaps we can take a question in the room. I saw someone's hand up earlier, or I didn't. Sir.
Yeah, so hi. My question is about Ukrainian payments. There was a news item somewhere. Somebody who was training there, he mentioned the news media here, that we are training that the people there who promote Nazism. So, and when I look at some of the photographs from the media also, they show those kind of things. So my point is, we training as a country, do we promote Nazism? Are we training Nazism, the people there, really? And if that's what we are doing, then we have to think about ourselves.
Yeah, right. So for the people online, the question was about the Canadian military. We're training troops in Ukraine. Many of them have been accused of being pro-Nazis. And so therefore, are we somehow contributing to something that we shouldn't be?
Right.
And this is certainly the Russian narrative for number one. But we also know that after the invasion of Crimea in 2014, when the Ukrainian military itself was so ineffective that local militias grew up in those areas, and some of them identified or used symbols that we would consider to be Nazism, pro-Nazism, and so pro-Nazi and so forth. The Azov battalion, we often see them in the media being seen as pro-Nazi. It's a line that Putin also used as a reason for his invasion of Ukraine. Of course, President Zelensky is Jewish, as a note. And his prime minister initially, when he came into power, was Jewish. And so I just throw that out on the table to say that these are very complex situations, but I don't believe that the Azov battalion or any of these little militias represent the Ukrainian armed forces writ large. So are we training Nazis in Ukraine? The answer is no, we're not. Simple as that. And we're training Ukrainian soldiers who are fighting for their country, men and women, who have absolutely nothing to do with Nazism or anything like it, but is a useful tool to be exploited by the Russians in our media to suit our own purposes. But I have to agree with you, because even in Victoria, where we have a large Ukrainian community, and there was a fundraiser, I think, earlier this year, someone showed up with a t-shirt with one of the symbols of those militias that were fighting in the south in Ukraine. And the symbology just reminds you, in this case, of the Waffen-SS. And you don't need that sort of thing.
I think with the news that there are quite a good chunk of people that's still supposed to identify data there.
Of?
Data, was a proponent of Nazism.
Okay, yeah.
And they're having the same kind of at that time.
Yeah, well, I when it comes to the issue of Nazism and who's who in that world, Putin reminds me more so of Hitler in his last days in the bunker in Berlin, ordering troops to the front that don't exist and telling his commanders what they should do, and they're afraid to tell him that they can't do it. And this is a sort of situation that we're in. And so when you do ask me, where are the Nazis in this particular fight, I would say they're on the other side of the front lines. Andrew, did you want to add to that?
You can go on all day on this one. I'll simply say that I heard the person say Bandera, and really it's the whole issue of Ukrainian nationalism and the Western Ukrainian nationalism, the history of World War II, and working with the Germans, killing the Jews, and so on and so forth. Whereas I think the primary motivation was very much sort of Ukrainian nationalism rather than anti-Semitism, although anti-Semitism, of course, is there. And the fact remains that because of this crossing, meshing, the Bandera colors, the red and the black, you still see them today, particularly in Western Ukraine, you see them, they have parades. But I saw it on TV the other night when the Ukrainian troops were, I think, retaking one of the towns in Luhansk. They hoisted on the one side the Ukrainian flag and the other side the Bandera flag. So that doesn't work all that well. It's complicated. But it's complicated.
Yeah. So I do have a question online. Andrew, it says, how much has the weakness of the United States contributed to the degradation of the overall situation?
Well, this is the geopolitics, right? So, yes, in 1991, 1992, this is what the Russians will argue against the unipolar world. The Americans were on top in the 90s, basically. And this brings in China now. So now you start thinking about China. And the Chinese, with their Russians as their junior partner, in effect now, are actually working against the American unipolar world, and the Americans have retreated. And you can argue this happened under Trump, but you can also argue it's before that. You can argue that Bush number two's venture into Iraq really hurt the United States internationally. The decline of power is a very complex thing, but certainly the American decline of power and the lack of the challenge to American unipolar world by both the Russians and the Chinese has had an effect. But it's an ongoing situation.
Yeah, whenever I think about the United States and people say the United States is weak and it's, well, in the case of Putin, decadent, I think back to the 1960s when the United States had 500,000 soldiers in Vietnam and Martin Luther King had been assassinated and Kennedy had been assassinated. We had the Cuban Missile Crisis in 1962. And I think America goes through these periods. And when I see America today and all of the troubles that they have experienced with Trump being in power and all of these things, the leaving Afghanistan, catastrophe for the Afghan people, you do start to wonder. But then I look at the Indo-Pacific, and the last time I checked, there were like 400,000 American military and civilian personnel deployed in the Indo-Pacific on various, in Japan and South Korea. And so this was one of Putin's complaints in his speech the other day. He said, those Americans, they have thousands of bases everywhere. That was his complaint. So, America does things at times that are very questionable. But if anything, what Putin has done for the West is galvanized the European Union, galvanized NATO, brought countries into NATO like Sweden and Finland. They'll eventually come in. It's just the Hungarian and the Turkish parliaments that haven't discussed whether or not those countries should be in NATO at this point. So he's in a sense revitalized the West. From the slump of Afghanistan, the embarrassments of what we did there. So yes, anybody in the room? I'll come to you in back, sir, in a second. Go ahead.
Do you think there's a correlation between Trump leaving office and Putin changing choosing to go into Ukraine somewhat soon after Trump left office. Give yourself a false sense of security with Trump.
Well, that's a good point. Andrew, and for the audience, the question was, is there a correlation between Trump being in power and Putin taking his chances with Ukraine? Do you think Trump's presence had anything to do with this?
Well, I mean, I think certainly Trump was a wild card, and there were all these rumors that he and Putin were behind the scenes kind of working together. But so it's hard to say, what would Trump have done in his bilateral meetings with Putin? Because Biden, I think, handled it fairly rationally. Biden was trying to avoid a war, and he didn't count on, or he couldn't count on, the extreme sort of security view of Putin's regime, whereas they went to war because they would lose in 11 years sort of thing. I think Biden, Trump would have been almost impossible to call on this one, because he's impossible to predict. So I think with Biden, we have a very rational application of American policy and power. With Biden, it was all over the place. And I guess the question is, what would the American administration behind Trump have done? And that's a question that's hard to resolve. I'm sorry, I don't have the answer.
So I'll take a question from online here, and then I'll come to you in the back there, sir. Yes. Wow. It's hard to know where to start. There are so many questions here. Yes. Let's see. Wow. You almost need a third person here.
Yeah.
There was one from Phil Bergman I saw.
Yeah. Do you want to come up and take some of those? So, because they're touching on so many important issues, and you worry that you're going to leave somebody's question off.
So just talking this one here.
You want to drag that over so you can see? Trying to. Yeah, there, I'll do that for you.
I thought a negotiated peace might involve Ukraine conceding Crimea, perhaps granting official language status to Russian. Are you suggesting that recent battlefield successes make Ukraine less likely to entertain such compromises?
Sure, I can have a go at that. I think whether you're in Riga, Tbilisi, Baku, Beijing, you're all recalculating your relationship with Moscow. And where you can take advantage of the particular situation, as you see Russia's influence diminishing. Perhaps in Tbilisi, they're looking at those maps of South Ossetia and Abkhazia and wondering if they should potentially try to retake them. Perhaps in Moldova, people are weighing up their options. In the case of Beijing, they might be thinking to themselves that they'll be able to negotiate some pretty good trade deals with those Russians down the road, because Moscow will be so weak at the end of this. And let's not forget that the Russian economy is GDP-wise is smaller than Canada's, right? So you wonder how a country can keep all of this up over the long, long term. And so in those places that I've mentioned, they're also reevaluating their own domestic situations. So what do we see in Latvia? Latvia, as I mentioned, 25% of the population is ethnic Russian. 37% of the population speak Russian at home. Well, Russian media is banned, but forget about sending your kids to school in the Russian language. That's not allowed anymore. It's Latvian only. So countries will be making these choices. And I think for us, we underestimate the hatred that exists in many of these capitals with Moscow for the occupations that have occurred, the KGB, the Stasi, finding out in East Germany that your friends were spying on you. I mean, this is that world, and we never fully understand it ourselves, but we are seeing nationalism playing itself out in often very ugly ways, but it is an impact of a lot of history in that particular region. So This is how I see it happening. And I think on the Ukrainian side, who were already limiting the Russian language, the use of the Russian language, they have to be careful here because it's vital ground for the Ukrainians not to lose Western support. So you don't necessarily want to go around banning this and banning that and having your troops run amok and put up flags that, you know, you don't want to see that sort of thing, because that is counterproductive in your relationship primarily with the West and the support that we're providing and continue to provide. And so for the Ukrainian government, they have to make tough choices as they move forward. Let's hope that they don't, seeing the advantage coming to them, go too far. This is the issue, because that can also prompt a response from Russia that could involve a more dire type of situation, right? So, Andrew?
Great. Yeah, thanks. I'll just pick right up on that, because that to me brings us to Crimea. And I think the oblast, the four of the other ones, no, there's four plus Crimea. Crimea is very singularly different. And I think a person asked about that. And I think for the Russians, that is, when you get to existential threats and interests, Crimea is that. The other four oblasts are not, in my opinion. Black Sea Fleet, we have to keep remembering, they are based there, they never left there. They are nuclear capable. They have nuclear weapons. So if one is to imagine a Ukrainian military operation that breaks through Kherson, the land bridge, breaks into and begins the conflict over Crimea, what's the Black Sea Fleet going to do with its nuclear weapons and so on? They really don't have another base to go to. In World War II, when the Germans pushed into Crimea, the Soviets pulled the Black Sea Fleet out and put it in Poti in Georgia, which was then part of the Soviet Union. That option doesn't exist anymore. So I think Crimea is where we get to the existential threat bit. And I think, Chris, when you say the Ukrainians may not want to go too far, and I think the subject of Crimea is up in the air.
Mm-hmm. Sir, in the back, you had a question.
Well, the original purpose of NATO, as I understood it, was to stop Russian aggression in Europe. What you described in your initial speech was NATO now becoming more of a global police force involved in Iraq and Afghanistan and places like that. My question really is, why is Canada in NATO? We have nothing to gain. The Americans get political and military and economic influence by being in NATO. We used to be peacekeepers. We go into places like Rwanda without weapons. We were respected for that worldwide. And now we've suddenly taken a side. I don't think it's going to make us any safer. I think in today's world, after 9/11 and that, it's made us more vulnerable. Why are we persisting this track?
So for Andrew and the online audience, the question was, essentially boils down to why are we in NATO? What has happened to us as peacekeepers, which is something that we were heavily engaged with in the past? And that question could be the subject of an entire course, but we'll do our best. Andrew, did you want to address that as a start?
Sure. I mean, the peacekeeping role, Canada was first and foremost at all ways a member of NATO. Let's talk 1949 onwards, right? Post-World War II. Canadian policy, defense policy was first and foremost the NATO commitment. You mentioned LAR and all that good stuff after Solingen up north. That's where we put most of our emphasis, our resources, and our activity. Peacekeeping then was a very effective secondary role for the Canadian forces, because it was also in the line of maintaining, in the Cold War context, trying to referee certain wars that neither superpower wanted to get out of control. And the first thing, the Pearson Initiative between Egypt and Israel in the Sinai, is a classic case in point. Canadian peacekeepers, although members of NATO there, but they went in as a sort of objective neutral force to help extricate the French and the British from a war situation that nobody wanted to get to go worse. So we use peacekeeping to facilitate a broader stability role in the context of the Cold War. Now, today, regrettably, peacekeeping is not all that effective. I mean, there are very few examples of effective peacekeeping forces in place. They exist, but they're really not all that well. We've had a very bad situation in Mali, for example. Canada tried to do something there. That's a semi-war-fighting peacekeeping role. But we got out of there in 6 months with our helicopter squadron. So it's very difficult, but NATO and defense deterrence has always been fundamental to Canada. And as Chris mentioned in his trips to Latvia, that from a defense point of view is really our primary focus. The commitment to Latvia as part of NATO's deterrent posture in this war is first and foremost, I would suggest.
Let me also answer that question, because there was a time when Canada was well known for our international peacekeeping. And we would put our personnel into some very, very difficult situations. And many Canadian peacekeepers were killed in that particular period. But for the last 20 years or so, we have basically left UN peacekeeping. We fund the United Nations, their peacekeeping fund. But if you were to check today online, you'd probably find that we have about 25 military personnel involved in UN peacekeeping and maybe 25 or so civilian police. So in many respects, it's now become part of our history. But I'd be the first to tell you that I think we have a very important role to play in UN peacekeeping. Our current government committed to expanding our role in UN peacekeeping, but never followed through. So that's what I would say there. Now, as to why we're in NATO, I can probably give you 100, textbook answers about all of this. Yes, it's an alliance, we're all together and so forth. But I guess the best way I could answer that is the sense of helplessness that Ukraine must have felt in those first 48 hours when Russia invaded. That who was coming to help them? Were they on their own? Were they going to be just taken off the map, so to speak? Now, we can argue that Canada's so far away that we're in a fireproof house, we don't need to worry about any of all of that. And sure enough, that's a fair argument. Maybe today, perhaps not tomorrow, I don't know. But what the members of NATO do know is that when one of them is in trouble, others will come to their help. So is it an insurance policy? Sure, absolutely. It is, because you just don't know when things will happen to you. And so that's about it. That's really all I can say, because I could come up with a list of 100 good reasons as why we should be in NATO. But at the end of the day, it's good to have friends. And I think this is a really important fact. The autocrats of the world, the Putins, the Xis, even the Erdogans, the Lukashenkos, they don't have any friends. They have transactional relationships, but they don't have friends. And amongst the democracies, as slow as we can be to pull ourselves together and do something, probably in Paris and Berlin and Rome, you have a friend. You don't always agree, but you'll have a friend helping you out when need be. And look, one of the things that we've seen in the European Union on the energy side is it's been amazing to see how Europe has responded to Russia's energy card. I would say this is the last time Moscow will ever threaten Europe with energy ever again, because the European Union has pulled together, found new pipelines, new contracts, and tried to help everyone out. And will somebody's thermostat need to be turned down in the winter? Yes, probably. But this has been a fundamental change that Putin has caused as well. So I think that's the best answer I can give to what is a very complex issue that you've raised. But thank you for raising it, because it's a question that we all ask ourselves. Why are we in NATO? And why are we not out there peacekeeping like we used to do? And I'm sure many of the online people that I know who are in this business would have better answers than I can give you today. I had a question from Paul Meyer. Paul, hello. And he said, will commitments made by NATO in the 1997 Founding Act with Russia, namely no nuclear weapons, no infrastructure, or no permanent troops deployed on the new NATO member states be respected going forward. And he wanted our opinion on that, Andrew.
Well, I mean, hi, Paul, old colleague of ours. I mean, that the nuclear, would they respect that? I mean, I think that we've gone beyond those days. I mean, yes, those are the 90s. When, you know, NATO, there was this understanding, would we expand? Should we expand? We had Partnership for Peace as a gap in 94. And this is, I think, the Russian narrative is basically they're saying, we expected kind of an end to all this stuff, and it didn't. You kept coming at us, which is why I keep mentioning that pivotal Putin speech in 2007 in Munich, where he basically says it's gonna stop, and basically we start getting onto a path of warfare, war eventually as a result of that. So I think I don't know where we're gonna end on this. I think there has to be a ceasefire of some sort, probably before Crimea. I know it's contradicting Ukrainian position on that, but I think there probably will be a ceasefire imposed on them. The 73 October war, 49 years ago, Israel had the bomb. Israel, behind the scenes, threatened to use the bomb against the Syrian and Egyptian forces if they persisted. And Kissinger did a shuttle diplomacy. A ceasefire was imposed. So I think we're seeing perhaps a bit of that, what happened 49 years ago in the Arab-Israeli wars, that perhaps we may see that now. Nobody wants a nuclear war.
Right. And in terms of permanent infrastructure, when I was in Latvia, we have a lot of infrastructure there. And I did sit down with a couple of our Canadian engineers, young majors, who rolled out various plans. And boy, we're building a lot of infrastructure in Latvia. And more of our Canadian troops are being there, stationed there permanently with their families. So I don't know much about the 1997 agreement itself, but there's a lot of infrastructure being built in Latvia for the use of NATO troops.
There's a sense that this war will have a huge impact on Russia eventually, maybe some kind of regime change, certainly changing the political system, maybe. What kind of an impact will it have on NATO? Because I think this gets back to the question that was asked before, right? I mean, NATO was originally established as a defense alliance against the Soviet Union. Right, and after the collapse of the Soviet Union, NATO in a way lost its way, lost its purpose, right? You no longer have the Soviet threat, so what does NATO do? Will this force NATO to kind of rethink its purpose?
So the question, Andrew, is about NATO with Russia. What happens if Putin was to go? What if Russia was no longer a player? What is the raison d'etre of NATO going forward?
So this is a question we asked ourselves in 1991 in Vienna. I was at the CSE, now OSCE, actually when the Cold War ended, and we were there with the Soviet Union just before it became the Russian Federation, and we're saying, well, the Warsaw Pact's gone. There's no more conflict, at least not ideological, and the great power thing hasn't really started yet. Why do we need NATO? That was a big question, and the first sort of, it was in Yugoslavia, the Civil War starting, and the Americans actually saying, well, let the European Union, or the EC, whatever it was called, European Community, sort this out. And the OSCE tried to do it at first, you know, sending the ice cream peacekeepers there and so on. Didn't work. Then NATO stepped in and helped to bring about the end of the Yugoslav Civil War in fits and starts, which gave NATO a bit of another raison d'etre. I mentioned that through the NATO thing in 99. Going to almost war with Russia over Pristina. So the point is that I think NATO got its second wind just de facto, that power politics didn't stop, okay? And basically power politics won't stop even if Putin goes. We don't know who's gonna take over from that. Russia is a great power. It will be a great power. It will not be destroyed. So the power balances and alliances that balances power, I think we'll continue.
Yeah, and I think also there was a time when in NATO, they were busily focusing on China and for the wider area. You know, if you were in Tehran, for example, in the Iranian government a few years ago, you woke up and you had a NATO training headquarters in Kabul. and you had a NATO headquarters still there in Baghdad. Initially, it was commanded by Canada, training the Iraqi military, but it's all nice, that's all good. But if you're Iranian, you're thinking, oh my gosh, NATO's over on that side of my country, NATO's on this side of the country. We know all of the Central Asian states have been Partnership for Peace countries since the mid 90s. We know much of the Middle East and Northern African countries are partner members with NATO. So NATO is, I don't think, an organization that will go away soon. It has its tentacles all over the place. And I would imagine that the raison d'etre would be ensuring stability wherever they happen to be, obviously to protect NATO's interests, us as well. But in time, if Beijing was really to become a big issue, I would imagine NATO would be looking at that. So I don't think the problem with these organizations is that once you get them, they're hard to get rid of. And I'm not saying that you should, you need to get rid of them. I just think that NATO itself will be with us for a long time to come. Yeah. Yeah. Wow.
Well, thank you so much, Chris and Andrew, for sharing your experience and your expertise on this really complicated, complex issue. I know there were lots of questions online that we didn't get to, and I appreciate all of the people posing those questions. I'm sure you could follow up with Chris or Andrew if you wanted to by email.
Yeah.
Their emails you're on. Just have to check the CIC website, or
they know where to find me.
Right. So thank you, everyone, for coming today, for people who were here in the audience and for people who were online. Global Fridays is going to take a bit of a break now for a few weeks. We have a number of things happening on the next few Fridays, so we're not going to have any presentations, but our next one will be November the 4th, and that's Claire McGovern from Simon Fraser University, and she's going to be talking about Scottish independence and the whole Scottish independence issue post-Brexit. So we really look forward to hearing that on the 4th of November. So thank you, everyone, and have a good rest of your afternoon.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Andrew.
Thank you. Great to see you. Great to work with you.
See you again.
Indeed.
Bye, online audience.